السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. Welcome to a live session of Ask an Imam. My name is Farhan Iqbal and this is a live session where you can ask any questions about Islam, about Ahmadiyyat and about other world religions. You are watching this program simultaneously on multiple platforms that includes Facebook, YouTube, Twitter, Twitch, and Africa TV. So on all these platforms, wherever you are, you can submit your questions and it would be my pleasure to respond to your questions. Answers are given in light of resources that are available on the official website of the Ahmadiyya Muslim Community, that is www.alislam.org. That is alislam.org. That is the official website of the Ahmadiyya Muslim Community. I've already started receiving questions. Salam from Muhammad Sahib. Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullah, and some others as well. I will get to your questions in just a moment. As you can see on the screen, I've already started receiving these questions and I'm able to see them. I'll get to your questions in just a second. Before I take your questions, just wanted to point out one very interesting point that has been given by the promised Messiah, peace be upon him, in his commentary of the Holy Quran. So one way of getting to this commentary of the Holy Quran by the promised Messiah, peace be upon him, is to go to alislam.org. On the top, you see on the top green bar, you see Holy Quran. So when you click on Holy Quran, you come to this page where all the Quran-related links are given. That includes the Quran search, the Quran reader, the Quran book browser, the download Holy Quran PDF. In the download Holy Quran PDF, click on the drop-down menu. You can see I have clicked on it. Go through it and search for Urdu Tafsir by Masih-e Maud. If you click on Urdu Tafsir by Masih-e Maud, you come to the page dedicated to this commentary. I mean, the promised Messiah alayhi salam did not write a formal commentary of the Holy Quran, but he did write the commentaries of verses of the Holy Quran in different books, in some of his sayings that were published. So this is a compilation of his statements, of his sayings, of his writings, wherever he has commented on different verses of the Holy Quran. So if you go to the fourth volume, and this is only available in Urdu, and then click on the online link, you will come to this page, and on this page I have gone to chapter 5 verse 4, and then I have gone to page 24. So an interesting point about the verse Al-Yawma Akmaltu Lakum Deenakum. This is chapter 5 verse 4. This day have I completed your religion for you. The promised Messiah alayhi salam talks about this verse and says that ikmal, or perfection of the faith, means that it doesn't just mean that God has revealed certain surahs and certain verses of the Holy Quran. It also refers to the perfection of the nafs and the perfection or cleansing of the hearts of the people. So it's not just, you know, when we talk about the completion of our faith, it is not just the words of the Holy Quran that have been completed or perfected. It is also in reference to the completion or perfection of the hearts. And the promised Messiah alayhi salam goes on to talk about the Sahaba, how they have been praised in the Holy Quran, and how they were converted from simple human beings, ordinary human beings, into men of high morals. And from men of high morals, they were converted into godly people, godly men. These Sahaba, these companions of the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And this is another aspect of the perfection of the Holy Quran, the perfection of the religion of Islam, the way it was taught and the way it became a part of the lives of the companions of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And there is some comparison he makes with the companions of other prophets, for instance, the companions of Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, according to the Bible itself. The New Testament accounts, some of the disciples of Jesus, they abandoned him at the time of the crucifixion. And one of them was actually the reason why he was arrested. Another one of them cursed him. So, the Quran, on the other hand, has praised the companions of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Just an interesting point that you can find on alislam.org. If you know how to read Urdu, you would be able to find this on alislam.org. Now, back to the questions that I have received in a large number. The questions, so some people have said salam, wa alaikum assalam, wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. One person has asked on YouTube is, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu, how do we get rid of an old Quran? I don't have a clear answer for you in this regard because I have never done that myself. Usually, I have a lot of copies of the Holy Quran with me. Usually, what I do is I donate it to the library. And in some cases, I have donated some copies of my of the Holy Quran from my library to the libraries in different mosques. So see if you can donate it to someone, or you can just give it to someone who wants to read the Holy Quran and doesn't have a copy of the Holy Quran. I've never done that myself. So I don't have a direct answer for you. But if it's in good enough shape, you can definitely pass it on to someone who might need it. All right. One person has asked from YouTube: did Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam take the names of all the people of the book and make up his own words? No, he did not. He did not take all the names of the people of the book. If you're referring to the prophets of Israel, yes, many of the biblical prophets are also mentioned in the Holy Quran. There's no doubt about that. But to suggest that he made it up would be wrong, because the kind of facts we learn about prophets of God from the Holy Quran are much superior to the kinds of facts that the Bible tries to convey to us. In fact, in some cases, the Bible says things about prophets of God which we deem inappropriate and we do not accept. And when it comes to the Holy Quran, we have a really true picture of righteous servants of God, and that is what we accept, and that is makes everything clear to us. The other thing you should remember about Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, is that we have an incomplete story of Jesus Christ in the Gospels. The oldest Gospel we have is the Gospel of Mark. And the Gospel of Mark is an unfinished ending. When the women go to the tomb to look for Jesus, Jesus is not there. And after that, they were told not to tell anyone because they were afraid. And then that's where I believe it's Mark chapter 9, where the Gospel of Mark abruptly ends. And this is the earliest gospel that we have about Jesus Christ, peace be upon him. So what happened after that? That is a question mark for everyone. We have an alternate ending of the Gospel of Mark. But of course, that is a later addition. It is not original to the story of Jesus Christ. The Holy Quran, on the other hand, gives us a complete story of what happened to Jesus Christ, peace be upon him. For instance, the Quran talks about how Jesus was saved from the cross. We have, even in the Bible, Jesus Christ praying to God on the last night before his crucifixion for that cup to pass away from him. The Quran tells us that that prayer was accepted by God Almighty, and Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, actually survived the cross. All right. If you want to know more about this, you can go to alislam.org. alislam.org, and type in Jesus in India in the search bar, and you will come across this link, which is a link to a downloadable book, Jesus in India, where all this is discussed at extensive length. All right, I hope that clears it for you. Question from Facebook. Okay, it's just a comment. It's in Urdu but written in Roman English. Let me read it first, try to understand what it is saying. The question is in Urdu, but this is an English program, so I will translate it and respond to your question in English. You have asked that is it possible that when it comes to religious differences, that we stop saying that the other is at fault and we just talk about peace? So I agree with you in that regard, that we should be very peaceful in our dialogue. And I've had some people in this program come here and they try to insult me and everything. And I told them very clearly that this is not a place where we are having debates or we're just trying to put the other person down. We are having a dialogue. We're having a question and answer session where you can ask any questions and I will try to respond to them the best I can. Wherever I don't know the answer, I will simply say I don't know, or I'll have to look into it more. So when it comes to talking peace, that's definitely something that we should be doing, and that's something that I definitely agree with you on. But at the same time, I will not give up my beliefs, or I will not change my beliefs just to appease anyone. I will be firm in what I believe in, and that's what I have presented. And so as long as we are respectful of one another and respectful of one another's differences, differences of opinion, intellectual differences, theological differences, whatever those differences may be, we can still have a healthy dialogue. All right. So that is something that we should. That is something that we should definitely follow. Is that we are respectful of one another, and we respect each other's opinions and positions, theological positions, and everything will be fine if we do that. All right. Lots of comments here. Interesting comments here. Let me see if I can see if there is a question somewhere here. One question from Twitter: how does one respond to someone who says that you are a good person? What is our humble response? You know, in the case of Hazrat Khalifatul Masih, that is the His Holiness Hazrat Mirza Masroor Ahmad, may Allah be his helper, the current caliph of the Ahmadiyya Muslim community, I've seen that, in accounts that are related to him, he avoids having the other person give too many good comments about him. And that is one way of staying humble, I believe. If we are always looking for praise and we are always looking for other people to praise us and to admire our efforts, then it can make it so that we start becoming arrogant about it. So we should try to avoid that and try to avoid those situations where there is too much praise. I mean, there is human nature which causes us to desire. You know, human nature has this desire, innate desire for praise and admiration. And even with Huzur, he always praises, in the case of His Holiness, he always praises when he sees something good that is done, that is a form of encouragement, but never so much that the other person becomes arrogant or, goes in the wrong direction. So always keep that in mind, I guess, in order to stay humble. The other thing we should do is, we should recite istighfar. The Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to recite istighfar 70 times. According to one hadith, he recites istighfar 70 times when he is in a gathering. So it's always good at an internal level to seek istighfar so that we are safeguarded from the harms of this kind of praise which can mislead us, okay? Okay. So the person, the Christian Jesus Emmanuel Israel, I guess this is just a username on YouTube. He has commented a lot on YouTube, and he has asked this question that how did the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam know the names Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob? The Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, of course, even before he became a prophet, he had some knowledge of the beliefs. Abraham was a very well-known personality in Arabia, including the city of Mecca. Even before the dawn of Islam, Abraham was well known among the people. Ishmael was well known because the people of Arabia were the descendants of Ishmael. And that's why, from their own traditions, they knew about Hazrat Ibrahim. In Arabic, his name is Ibrahim. And Ismail, that is the name, the Arabic name of Hazrat, of Prophet Ishmael. So, of course, he knew about them even before the coming of Islam, but his true knowledge about them came to him from God Almighty. The Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, may peace and blessings of God be upon him, is a true prophet of God. He came in accordance with the prophecies even found in the Bible, and he came with a message from God Almighty, and he's a true prophet, and we know that based on the criteria we have from the books of God, including the Bible, including the Bible. What kind of prophecies were made about Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam? How do we know that he is a fulfillment of those prophecies? You can learn more about this from alislam.org. If you go to alislam.org and type in the search bar Bible prophecies, okay, biblical prophecies about Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This is one article that you can go through, which talks about the prophecies regarding Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam from the Bible. Similarly, we have other resources available here. There is one that is called Muhammad in the Bible. Muhammad in the Bible. Type in the search bar Muhammad in the Bible, and you will come across this book, which is by Hazrat Mirza Bashiruddin Mahmud Ahmad, the second caliph of the Ahmadiyya Muslim community. He wrote this book where he lists the prophecies regarding Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam that are found in the Bible. I recommend that you have a look at this book before making any conclusions about Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and in the Bible. Hashim has asked on YouTube, when can you give azan? What is the time? So whenever it's the time for prayer, you can give the azan. In the case of Fajr prayer, I'm not sure if you're asking about any specific azan, and so any specific prayer time. But for instance, if it is Fajr time, usually the breaking of dawn happens about 1 hour and 20 minutes, 1 hour and 18 minutes before sunrise. This is something that I find in Canada, in most of southern, in most of Ontario, southern Ontario. You can say that usually about 1 hour and 18 minutes before sunrise is the breaking of dawn. And sorry, I'm not just saying that. That is based on scientific data, and you can get the exact time when this happens from certain websites online. When the azan can be called for Fajr, and then Fajr prayer can be offered. But even if it's offered a little bit later, it's fine. Usually, for a mosque setting, we try to be very accurate with the time. But for if you're offering nowadays at home and you want to give the azan, there is some leniency where you can offer the azan at a little bit of a later time. Similarly, for other prayers for Zuhr, it should be after the sun has reached its highest point in the sky. So again, in southern Ontario nowadays, it's probably around 12:15, 12:20 p.m., 12:25 p.m., or 12:30 p.m. You can check. There are websites that you can just Google which will tell you when is the sun at the highest point in the sky in your region, wherever you're from. And then the Asr time is when the sun has gone further down the sky, and that's when Asr can be offered. Maghrib is right after sunset, so usually sunset time is also easily available on Google, and 3 or 4 or 5 minutes after sunset, you can call the azan and offer Maghrib. So these are some of the azan times, but if you are asking about some specific issue with that, then I can address that. You know, this is a general answer about giving azan. How can we answer to Muslims who say wishing on New Year's is haram because it is imitation of a people, as in the Hadith? Now, the Hadith says that we should not imitate people who are doing something wrong, but Hadith also says innamal amalu bin niyat, all actions are to be judged based on intentions. All right. So if your intention is pure and you're not trying to imitate the people as in become completely like them, and you're just wishing a new year along with prayers, along with the suggestion that you want Allah, you want God to make the new year better, and you have that intention, then it's okay. It's not necessary that this would be wrong, and it does not become an imitation of a people just because you have done, just because you have wished someone well. In the life of the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, also he interacted with people of other faiths with kindness, with compassion. Once a funeral of a Jewish person was passing by, and the Holy Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, stood up as in respect. Now, was he imitating them? No, he was not imitating them, but he was showing them his respect at an important occasion like that. So in the same way, if we are just wishing them well and we are not engaging in any kind of sin and we have no ill intention, then in those cases, it is fine to wish someone well for the new year. Okay. Hussein has pointed out, again from YouTube, that a video was made by Dr. Tony Costa on Ahmadiyya Muslims and lied about the promised Messiah, peace be upon him. Have you seen and can you refute it? Can you kindly send me an email at askanimam@alislam.org. Send me the link so I can have a look at it and see if that needs to be responded to. Okay, lots of comments here. I'm seeing if I can find the question. One person has said salam from Facebook. Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullah. One person from Facebook has asked, why was there no Jewish prophet after Jesus, peace be upon him, especially after his people considered him as the literal son of God, either before or after Christianity became a formal religion in Roman Empire? Why wait until Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, a non-Jewish messenger, hundreds of years later? Please advise. You see, the thing is that after Jesus Christ, the people did not just quickly become corrupt. It is not that people deviated and right away became evil or right away went in the wrong direction. Certainly, there was a group of Christians who believed that Jesus Christ is God, and they had gone into the wrong direction and they had gone astray. But to think that they had completely lost the right path, and right away after Jesus, a new prophet was needed. God Almighty sends a prophet when there is a need, when there is an actual need. So in the case of Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, in the years after, in the decades after, there was no immediate need for people to have a new prophet. After Jesus Christ, for all those decades and for hundreds of years, the misguidance took hundreds of years to develop. So we have that council of Nicaea that came in after 300 years after Jesus. And then there is the council of Constantinople, which comes another 40, 50, 60 years later. And then the idea that Mary is the mother of Jesus in the sense that she has some divine status as well, or she can intercede, you can pray to her, those kinds of ideas as the, you know, that Mary is the mother of God, that started developing in the 5th century. So it is a very gradual increase. And the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was sent as the last final messenger for humankind at the time when these issues had become widespread. And even at his time, you must note that the king of Abyssinia, where some of the Muslims, early Muslims, went to take refuge, he also said that, "I don't consider Jesus to be any greater than what you have just described." He was confronted about it, and when there was a discussion between Muslims and him, he acknowledged that he believed Jesus Christ to be simply a human being, peace be upon him. So God sent the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, exactly when the time was right, exactly when he was needed, exactly according to the prophecies. So it happened quite literally when it was the perfect time for Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, to come. So it's not that just 10 years after Jesus dies, a new prophet is needed. It took some time before there was a real need for another prophet to come. Okay. If the government of Yemen wanted to destroy the Kaaba because millions of people used to come for Hajj, didn't Hajj start after the advent of Islam? I believe you are talking about the time when the Ashabul Fil, when the people of the elephant came to destroy the Kaaba. Now, as far as that event is concerned, you should note that even before the coming of the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the Kaaba was still a central place. The Kaaba was still a place where people came for performing circuits, and you know, so Hajj is the sanctified version of that worship that did exist in some form before. It's just when the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam came with divine guidance, he perfected the process. He perfected the process according to what God Almighty desired. Based on divine guidance, he perfected that process. Before he came, of course, there was some kind of performance of Hajj and going around the Kaaba, and those things did exist, but they were not perfected yet. Remember the verse of the Holy Quran that I talked about in the very beginning? It's in chapter 5, verse 4. Al-yawma akmaltu lakum dinakum. So the Quran says that today the religion has been perfected. So it doesn't mean that there was no religion even before Islam. It doesn't mean that there was nothing before Islam. Things were there, right? But there was confusion about it. There were misconceptions about it. There were things not known. There were things that some people were performing the Hajj in abhorrent ways. So all those un-Islamic and polytheistic ideas were abolished. The Kaaba had 360 idols. Those were removed. So all these things that had corrupted the true worship were removed, and the pure, pristine form of worship that should be done was started with the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I hope you understand my point here in regards to this. All right. Jesus said he was sending out teachers, prophets, and apostles so that they may teach or preach the truth, no lies. Okay. So this is, I am getting a lot of comments. One person, Zishan, has asked that I wanted to ask that if he faxed a letter to Huzoor from home, will we get charged for long distance rates? You have to talk to your local company and see what their rates are. Usually they are very low. All right. Lots of comments here. I am trying to see if there is a question here. One person has asked from YouTube, do we have evidence that we are the fastest growing group in Islam? Are we the fastest growing group in Islam or not? If you just do a general search on the internet does bring up some references which suggest or point out that the Ahmadiyya Muslim community is the fastest growing Muslim community in the world among all the Muslims. Now, is this something that we can prove in other ways? I can talk about subjective facts. For instance, when I look around, my own observation, and when you look around in your own observation, the most dynamic Muslim community, which one is it? Which community is holding the largest conventions? Which community is holding the largest or is building the largest mosques in their vicinities, in their districts, in their cities, in their countries, right? Which community has the largest consistent audiences in their mosques, or rather congregations in their mosques? So you look at all these facts, which community is showing that kind of potential? It is because of our activities that recently on Google, whoever searched for the present Caliph of Islam, the search results said that it is Hazrat Mirza Masroor Ahmad, may Allah be his helper. Now, that doesn't, our belief in Hazrat Mirza Masroor Ahmad as the Caliph of Islam does not depend on a Google search, but it gives you an indication that our preaching efforts, our efforts to take this message to the rest of the world, are coming to fruition with the help of Allah, with the grace of Allah. As Allah himself told the promised Messiah, peace be upon him, I shall cause thy message to reach the corners of the earth. So we see that happening. We see that when we see that Allah has caused this message to reach the corners of the earth. And that is why Google is just giving us the response that most people are hearing about, that most people know about, that has been verified through multiple factors in play. So Google is just acknowledging the reality. It's not that Google is telling us something new. It's just acknowledging the reality that the message of Islam Ahmadiyyat is reaching all parts of the world. Which Muslim leader in the world is telling world leaders about Islam, about God? Which Muslim leader in the world is writing letters to world leaders and telling them about God Almighty and warning them about punishment of God, which may come if they don't change their ways, if they don't give their due rights to God and due rights to humanity? So if you look at all these facts, it's almost undeniable that the Ahmadiyya Muslim community is the fastest growing group within Muslims. Okay, and you see the practical aspects of that as well when you see the converts who are joining our Jamaat and community. So you see all that together. All right. What is the response? This is a question from Twitter. What is the response to a Christian who says that God is very pleased with them? He listens to their prayers. God is, in the very beginning, Allah says in the Holy Quran, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, in the name of Allah, the Gracious, the Merciful. And then it says, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, all praise belongs to Allah, Lord of all the worlds. So Allah is the Lord of everyone. Allah is gracious. It is part of the Rahmaniyat, which is the graciousness of God Almighty, that He provides for all human beings and He takes care of all human beings. So that is true. He, in that sense, He is providing and His grace encompasses all people, regardless of which religion they belong to. So we don't have to respond to them. We have to tell them that the God that they are worshipping and the God, the true God that they should be worshipping, or the true God who does listen to the prayers, is the one that is presented by Islam. So because they are Christian, they have access to the Old Testament. That's what the Christians call it, but it is also known among academia as the Hebrew Bible. So the Hebrew Bible is talking about the same God that Islam speaks of. Islam has presented the attributes of God in a much purer, much clearer, more transparent form. But if you look at the Hebrew Bible, it talks about God with the same attributes. So Christians have access to that, and they have a picture of God that is not too different from the understanding of God in Islam. The only difficulty we have is that they believe in a triune God. But even when you talk about a triune God, many Christians may not think of God in that way. When you speak to Christian preachers, they will talk about all these technical terms in order to somehow prove the divinity of Jesus Christ. But the real God, the real personal God that most Christians would relate to, would be the one God which is also presented in Islam. So they might have, they might have a concept which is very similar. There are some Christians who convert to Islam and they talk about how they never saw Jesus as divine, and they always considered God as one in an absolute sense. So there is that aspect to this as well, which we see, and that impacts those who are worshiping. So we have to talk to them in a gentle way, in a compassionate way, talk to them about the Islamic concept of God and how He's the one who listens to their prayers and responds to it. The other interesting thing to remember is that when it comes to the Christian concept, you know, when it comes to Jesus Christ, He's praying to God the night before His crucifixion. Now, as Muslims, we say that prayer was accepted. He was taken to the cross, but He was taken down alive. That cup that He was praying to God, oh God, let this cup pass from me. That cup did pass from Him as He prayed, and His prayer was accepted. So from our perspective, God did accept the prayer of a human being who was close to Him, who was His servant, who was a prophet. God did listen to him. It's just that, when it comes to the Christian perspective, they would say, no, that prayer was not accepted, and he just died on the cross. So that's another angle to look at it. But these are just a few points for you to think about, and you can talk to them more about this and get a better communication with them. Question from Facebook: do Jews and Muslims believe in the same God? And is it that they have just rejected Jesus Christ, peace be upon Him? Jews and Muslims do believe in the same God. I would not say that the concept of God is different in the Hebrew Bible as compared to the Quran. They have just rejected, the Jews have rejected Jesus Christ, peace be upon Him, and they have also rejected the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, peace and blessings of God be upon him. So more, as far as our Jewish brothers and sisters are concerned, our difference from them is that they do not believe in the prophethood of Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, and the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So we talk to them about the truthfulness of these prophets when we have dialogues with them. But as far as the concept of God is concerned in the Hebrew Bible, like I just mentioned, as compared to the Holy Quran, the attributes of God are all the same. The only difference is that the Quran presents those attributes in a much more powerful, much more beautiful way. Hussein has asked about Dr. James White. I'm not sure if that does trigger a memory. I believe that Dr. James White is the person who talks about the preservation of the Holy Quran. If that is the case, then I do have some opinion about him. But, you know, this might not be the platform for me to be discussing certain individuals. If you have a question about what he says, then maybe I can respond to that. One person has asked a question from YouTube in Roman English. Let me try to understand what he's saying. Okay, so this question is about a hadith where the Holy Prophet sallallahu, and because you have asked this question in Urdu, just want to inform you that this program is in the English language, so you can send a question in Urdu, and then I will respond in the English language. The question that I just read from YouTube, it's saying that the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that this ummah would not become corrupt as long as I am at its beginning, and in the middle is the Imam Mahdi, and in the end is Isa ibn Maryam. First of all, these kinds of ahadiths, we have to always look at their authenticity. Where are they reported from? Who is narrating it? And what is the context? Second of all, do remember that when it comes to the Imam Mahdi, there are so many narrations, and it is virtually impossible to make them all, put them all together and not have any contradiction. There is no narrative that will make us understand that all these ahadiths are true when it comes to the Imam Mahdi. In fact, there are so many narrations about the Imam Mahdi that that were seemingly contradicting one another that both Sahih Bukhari and Sahih Muslim did not include any narration about the Imam Mahdi in their compilations. So there's no hadiths about the Imam Mahdi specifically in Sahih Bukhari or Sahih Muslim. They do mention about the coming of Jesus Christ, the promised Messiah, but there's no mention of the Imam Mahdi. The other thing is that the words Imam Mahdi do not necessarily refer to one person. The Imam Mahdi refers to multiple people who will come throughout the history of Islam and who will come to reform people, bring people back to the right path. So we have that in the case, for instance, throughout the history of Islam, we have had Mujaddideen, and some of them, they did such great work that they can be considered the Mahdi in their time, in the sense that the word Mahdi just means the guided one. So in that sense, the word Mahdi can apply to many personalities instead of just one personality. And then, so in fact, if the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is referring to the Imam Mahdi in between, it could be one of those personalities. And then the Isa ibn Maryam at the end of this ummah is in reference to the promised Messiah and the Imam Mahdi. The Imam Mahdi of the highest status, which is the promised Messiah, Hazrat Mirza Ghulam Ahmad, peace be upon him. So there's that angle to study these ahadiths. First of all, of course, we look at their authenticity, narration, where they're coming from, and then we look at their meanings, and if it's possible to reconcile, that's the word I was looking for, reconcile these narrations with other narrations that are similar. All right. This question has disappeared underneath some other questions. How was the Old and New Testament revealed or compiled? These books are not revealed by God Almighty. You know, when as a Muslim we say a book is revealed, we are thinking about the Holy Quran, every word, every letter, every syllable coming to us from God Almighty and being written down right away, being memorized right away. None of that happened with the Old and New Testaments. The Old and New Testaments are basically accounts written by historians. So, for instance, in some cases, it's possible that one of the prophets himself wrote down his observations and his revelations. But those revelations are not word-for-word revelations. So, if, for instance, the prophet Jeremiah is writing a revelation that he received, it is usually in his own words. It is paraphrased, and he's delivering the revelation in his own words to his people, and is being written down. But that is very rare in the Bible to actually have any portion of the Bible which is believed to have been written by the prophet himself. In most cases, these are written by some of the disciples of the prophets or some unknown historian. In fact, most of the books are written anonymously, by the way. Even those portions that are assumed to have been written by a prophet are not signed by that prophet. So it's just tradition telling us that that portion must have been written by the prophet. For instance, the Psalms of David. Tradition assumes that these are written by David, the prophet, peace be upon him. But how much of it was actually written by David, we don't know, because most of it is anonymous. It's not written by, it's not signed by anyone. No one. David didn't say that I am David and I'm writing this, right? So. And in each book of the Bible is a different case study. Each book, and there are so many books, right? 66 books. So it's impossible for me to give you a general answer. But when it comes to, your general understanding, the Old Testament and the New Testament are both written anonymously in most cases, and they are works of historians. So for instance, in the case of Isaiah, for instance, there were some scrolls on which the prophet Isaiah or one of his disciples wrote down his teachings, and those scrolls were kept. And then after many decades and a couple of centuries later, someone comes and compiles it into a book. And the actual writing of the book was probably closer to 300 BCE. So the Bible, from the time of Moses till the time of this writing, sorry, my camera died there for a second. So from the time of Moses to the time of writing, 1,000 years had elapsed before a formal writing process even began, right? So there's a lot of unknown out there, and there's a lot of process that these books went through. And of course, you would have to take a course to understand all of this, or read a book to understand all of this at more length. All right, I am now coming closer and closer to the end of my live stream. Let me take two or three more questions before we bring this to an end. Question from YouTube. I read in a hadith that the meat of a cow is a disease. I don't have the reference. I was wondering if this meat is unhealthy, as many people believe it is today. I am not sure of this hadith. I've not seen it or heard of it. If you want, you can, if you find the reference, send it to me, askanimam@alislam.org, and I'll have a look at it and try to understand it. But beef is not forbidden in Islam, consumption of beef. That's something that is okay. And if there's a hadith that says something like that, you have to send it to me, the reference. I do not believe that there is a hadith of this nature, but it's up to you. You can check further into this. One question from Twitter. What happened after the crucifixion to the disciples of Jesus? What were their beliefs about Jesus? We don't know much about the disciples. What happened to them? Where did they go? There is some brief history about them in the book of Acts. It's called Acts of the Apostles. There are some disciples mentioned, but even in the Acts of the Apostles, there's a lot of focus on Paul. And Paul was not a real apostle. He came to believe in Jesus after Jesus was gone from that region. So as far as the other apostles, they are briefly mentioned. We do have Paul having disagreements with the other apostles, though that is definitely mentioned. For instance, in the book of Galatians, Paul actually himself talks about his differences of opinion some of the disciples of Jesus. There were some early debates, and now is not the time for me to get into those, but there were some debates that they were having. So those differences of opinion were already, we began to see them. There is one of the disciples who was definitely opposed to Paul, who stayed in Jerusalem, and his name slips my mind. And we do have some historical data that points out to him being opposed to Paul and opposed to preaching to the Gentiles, as Paul was doing. And he stayed in Jerusalem and continued with the message of Jesus. And that group, with their teachings, appears to have been a group that influenced a later group that came out to be known as the Ebionites. So in the second century, there's a group of Christians known as the Ebionites who saw Jesus as only a messenger of God and not more than that. So we have that example of the Ebionites. And then later on, we have Jewish Christians, Unitarians. So there's always been a sect within Christianity that believed that Jesus is just a messenger, a human being, and not a divine being, as some other Christians believed in. So there's that aspect also that can be traced all the way back to Jesus. They're usually known as Jewish Christians. You know, some scholars call them Jewish Christians that have always existed. Question from YouTube: why does God allow for the Quran to be misinterpreted? Why does God allow the Quran to be misinterpreted by the wrong people? Well, if certain people misinterpret the Quran, God cannot be held responsible. You know, the issue to be understood here is that God wants to grant us our free will. If he wanted, he could have turned us into angels and all of us could have believed in the Holy Quran and all of us could have had no power to do evil and we would have been fine and we would have been like angels. But to be human means that we have a choice between good and evil. And in this case, we have, you know, the Quran, but, you know, there are people out there who reject the Quran. There are people out there who have, you know, misinterpreted or purposely, sometimes even intentionally, used verses of the Holy Quran for their own benefit and taking them out of context and all that. So it's not that God cannot be held responsible for the actions of these human beings who have been granted free will. God has granted us free will, the choice between good and evil. How we use that choice is up to us. I hope that partially at least answers your question. Okay, Hussein has said that Dr. James White said Ahmadis are to Muslims what Jehovah's Witnesses are to Christians. That is his opinion. As far as I'm concerned, I don't see any parallels between the two, but that's up to him. Okay, one or two questions. Zishan is asking that does Jamia Ahmadiyya have any photography courses? No, Jamia Ahmadiyya is an institution for comparative study of religions. So you study Islamic sciences, you study the Holy Quran, you study the translation of the Quran, you study the language, Arabic, Urdu, you study the commentary of the Holy Quran. You study ahadith, sayings of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, especially Sahih Bukhari. They go through most of Sahih Bukhari. They study fiqh, which is basically jurisprudence, history of Islam, history of Ahmadiyya. These are the topics that are taught in Jamia Ahmadiyya. But if you have an inclination for a photography, you can continue that as a personal hobby. If you are considering going to Jamia, that is something that is good, and I encourage that. Last question I'm going to take is, what is the story of Paul? This question is coming to us from Twitter. What is the story of Paul? Is he the reason for the concept of Trinity, atonement? Yes, primarily he is the one who introduced the idea that Jesus died for the sins of the people and for their he was crucified for their sins. So Paul is the one who introduced these ideas. Interestingly, Paul, in all of his letters, you know, most of the New Testament are letters of Paul, right? The book of Galatians is a letter of Paul. The book of Corinthians is a letter of Paul. The book of Thessalonians is a letter of Paul. These books or letters never quote Jesus. It's interesting that Paul is always talking from his own perspective. He's never quoting Jesus Christ, never saying that Jesus said this, and so we must believe in this. And so it's interesting that introduces these ideas and concepts. I recently had a chance to write, or rather publish. I actually wrote it sometime back, a couple of years ago, but recently, in mid-2020, one of my books, The Myth of the Divinity of Jesus Christ, Peace Be Upon Him, was published. And in that book also, I discuss some of these topics, if you're interested. And hopefully, when it comes on alislam.org, and shouldn't take too long now, I will announce its availability on alislam.org. But if you are interested in getting more information about this book, you can send me an email at askanimam@alislam.org. Jazakallah, I really appreciate all of you joining me. Today I had a record number of audience. I really appreciate all of you who joined this program and stayed and benefited. Please do remember me and the alislam.org team in your prayers. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu.